Yesterday we gave the fundamental definition of shift on topological space, and with the purpose of getting to the categorical definition of shifts on a site, we introduced the language of sieves. So let's recall that a sieve on an object in a category is a collection of arrows to that object, which is closed under composition on the right. As we remarked yesterday, this idea of closing a given family of arrows to a given object by composition on the right has the advantage that it makes possible to express the condition for a given family to be compatible without requiring the intersections to exist as in the topological case. So yesterday we made this remark, which actually is what we need to define a notion of matching family in the categorical setting, and then a notion of shift in the same setting. Okay, so let's introduce the fundamental definition of Grothendieck topology on a category, which is what is meant to replace the notion of covering of an open set in a topological space by a family of open subsets. So a Grothendieck topology on a category is just a way of assigning to each object of the category a collection of sieves on that object in such a way that some natural conditions are satisfied. These conditions are the following. First, we require the maximality axiom, which is simply the assertion that the maximal sieve on each object should stay in the topology. Then we have the pullback stability axiom, which says that any pullback of a sieve belonging to the topology should again belong to the topology. Again, it doesn't need a lot of justification because it is a very natural requirement. In fact, yesterday we gave the definition of pullback of a sieve along a certain arrow. So if you have a sieve S on an object C, you can pull this back along H to get a sieve on D, which will consist of the arrows that, when composed with H, belong to S. So the pullback stability axiom refers to this construction. So in order to concretely understand this in the setting of topological spaces, let's just postulate that, when we have X topological space, we can naturally define a Grothendieck topology on the category of open sets of the space, which we introduced yesterday, by saying that. So this will be called the canonical topology on this category. So we postulate that a given family of arrows in this category going to a given object, so to a given open set. So just a family of arrows will be, since arrows are inclusions, it will be just a collection of inclusions of sub-open sets into a given open set. So then we postulate that such a family belongs to the topology if and only if the open set U is actually covered by the UI in the classical topological sense. And so you understand the pullback stability condition holding in this particular case, because it amounts precisely to the infinite distributive law. Because you see, if you have a sub-open set V of U, and U is covered by a family of open subsets UI, actually, when you pull this back, what you will get is the family of these intersections, which certainly cover V, because of the fact that this infinite distributive law holds. So from this you understand that actually the pullback stability condition is a natural condition, but is not a trivial one, because it requires a certain distributivity to hold at least, I mean, in this particular case. In fact, there is a third axiom in the definition of Grothendieck topology, which is what you see there in the slides, the transitivity axiom, which is again quite natural, because it says that if you have a certain sieve R such that all its pullbacks along the arrows in a sieve which is in the topology are in the topology, then the sieve itself should be in the topology. So it is a sort of converse to the pullback stability, sort of reflexive property. And in fact, this axiom is less fundamental than the pullback stability axiom, because in fact, as far as sieves are concerned, if you start with a collection of sieves in a category which satisfies the maximality and pullback stability conditions, you can always generate a Grothendieck topology out of it by taking the intersection of all the Grothendieck topologies which contain this. And when you look at the sieves, as we shall define them in a moment, with respect to one or the other, they will be the same. So it means that actually the two key conditions are really, well, the maximality condition, which of course is quite trivial, but I mean the pullback stability condition is really crucial. Okay, so the sieves which belong to the given topology will be called the covering sieves for this topology. So we shall say that the sieve is J covering if it belongs to J. Okay, so now we can define the notion of site as simply a pair consisting of a small category and a Grothendieck topology on it. And this will be the basic categorical settings for defining sheaves in full generality. Before giving this definition, let's just present a few basic examples of Grothendieck topologies. Well, of course, what you can remark is that for any small category, you can always define a Grothendieck topology on it in a trivial way, just by taking the maximal sieves on all the objects of the category. Of course, all the axioms are trivially satisfied. This actually is important because when we shall define sheaves on a site, we will see that sheaves on trivial sites, I mean sites where the topology is trivial, they are just pre-sheaves. So one gets pre-sheaves by taking sheaves with respect to the trivial topology. Then there is a more interesting topology that one can put on any category. It's called the dense topology, and it's defined by saying that sieves which cover are precisely the stably non-empty ones. So by stably non-empty, I mean that this condition here holds, which is the same thing as saying that these are sieves such that their pullback along any arrow is non-empty. Now, things simplify if our category satisfies the right or condition, which is the property that any pair of arrows with a common codomain can be completed to a commutative square. Because in this situation, one immediately sees that the pullback of a non-empty sieve is again non-empty. And so the definition of the dense topology simplifies, and we get what is called the atomic topology, which is defined as the topology whose covering sieves are precisely the non-empty ones. This will be useful for us for understanding, for instance, Galois theory from a topospheretic perspective. So we shall come back to this in tomorrow's lecture. Okay, now let's go on with other examples of Grothendieck topologies. Of course, we have already remarked that when we have a topological space, there is a natural Grothendieck topology associated with it on the category of its open sets, which is what I have written here. So it is actually the canonical topology on this category. One can define a notion of canonical topology on any category, which is the largest coverage for which all the representables are sheaves. And so in this particular case, we get that topology. Now, more generally, yesterday we have talked about pointless topology and the fact that topos theory actually generalizes pointless topology rather than classical topology, in the sense that when you define sheaves on a topological space, you basically forget about the points of the space and you only focus on the lattice theoretic structure of the category of its open sets. So, since you don't actually use the points, what you could do, if you start with just a frame, which is a complete lattice where the infinite distributive law holds of arbitrary joints with respect to finite finites, of course, you can also define a Grothendieck topology on such a frame, which is also called the canonical topology and which is defined like this. We say that a given family of elements below a given element A covers if and only if the join of all these elements is equal to the given element. And in fact, what makes the pullback stability condition satisfied is precisely the infinite distributive law, which holds on a frame by definition of a frame. In fact, the frames are the basic objects of study in pointless topology, because in fact you remark immediately that the category of open sets of a topological space is a frame. So in fact, frames can be regarded also from a logical viewpoint as a complete Heiting algebras, because in fact you can immediately see that on any frame you have, for any pair of elements A and B, an element which is denoted like this, which satisfies this universal property that an element is less than or equal to this if and only if you have that. So this is of course an adjunction property. You see here I have used this notation of the implication because in fact it makes sense to interpret intuitionistic propositional logic disconnected in intuitionistic propositional logic as this operation in a frame. So things become sound when you do that. But we shall come back to this point later when we talk about the internal logic of a topos, which in fact is precisely due to a Heiting algebra structure which exists on all subobject lattices in the topos. Okay, so for the moment let's continue with other examples of Grothendieck topologies. Well, suppose you have a small category of topological spaces which is closed under finite limits and undertaking open subspaces, then in such a situation it is natural to define Grothendieck topology called the open cover topology by specifying as a generating basis the collection of open embeddings which cover a given space. Then of course I couldn't miss a fundamental example of Grothendieck topology, which plays a crucial role in algebraic geometry, the Zariski topology, which for instance can be defined, this is the basic example, of course you can define it over an arbitrary ring, but here let's just give the definition for the basic ring Z. We consider the opposite of the category of finitely generated commutative rings with unit, which is the same thing as finitely presented commutative rings with unit, and we postulate that a sieve in this opposite category, or here I have written co-sieve in the category of such rings, is covering if and only if it contains a finite family of canonical maps of this particular form. So this notation AFI indicates the localization of the ring A at an element Fi. So I take all finite families of arrows of this form where we take elements f1, fn, which are not contained in any proper ideal of the ring. So it means that they generate the ideal generated by all is the whole ring. And so you can easily see that this is indeed a Grothendieck topology, and so the topos which you get by taking sheaves on this site is called the Zariski topos. Of course, there are many other Grothendieck topologies that you can put on the same category and which also are relevant for many other purposes in geometry. In fact, in general, if you fix a category, there exist in general infinitely many Grothendieck topologies that you can put on it. So you have a great degree of freedom because you see, in the notion of site, you have a basic category, so it means that you have 2 degrees of freedom given by objects and arrows. And then when you put a Grothendieck topology, you add a further degree of freedom, which is provided by the covering sieves. So basically, you have really 3 degrees of freedom, which make you understand how general the notion of site is. And so it makes you understand that you can find sites basically in any area of mathematics, because of course categories can be found everywhere, and of course in many situations you can find suitable Grothendieck topologies to put on them to get sites. Of course, all of this becomes interesting when you pass to the category of sheaves on these sides and you look at the invariance of this category of sheaves, you are able to capture some important property written in the language of the original site that you are interested to investigate. And so, in this way, you are able to exploit the fundamental duality existing between sites and toposes. But we shall come back to that, especially in tomorrow's lecture. Okay, so now let's give the formal definition of a sheaf on a site. So first, as we did in the topological setting, we define what a pre-sheaf is. So a pre-sheaf on a small category is simply a contravariant functor from the category to the category of set. Then we have to define what a compatible family of elements of a pre-sheaf is. So we give the definition of a matching family of elements of a pre-sheaf indexed by the arrows of a covering sieve by saying that we should have an element XF indexed by any arrow F in the sieve, and that we should have this compatibility condition that, so basically we require so if we have an arrow F in our sieve, we want to have an element, and we want that if I consider the composite of my arrow with another arrow, because remember that we are in the context of sieves, so when we compose an arrow in the sieve with an arrow on the right, the composite arrow should again be in the sieve, and so I should have another element corresponding to that, because I should have one element for each arrow in the sieve. So if I have an element corresponding to F, I should also have an element corresponding to F composed with G, and this of course will belong to that. And you see the compatibility relation is that, you see, if we look at what happens at the level of the pre-sheaf, so here we have x of f, here we have x of f composed with g, and of course I can apply the pre-sheaf to that in order to get an element here, and the compatibility condition is this equality. So you see, this is a very elegant way to get rid of the problem of considering intersections, because you actually don't need intersections to express the compatibility condition. The only thing you need is to consider things that can be composed with all the arrows in your coloring family. This is the crucial remark which allows us to consider covering notions on arbitrary categories, not just the categories where you have finite limits. Okay, so now we know what a matching family is, then we define the notion of an amalgamation of such a family, and this is, as in the topological setting, defined as a single element of this, which is sent by the pre-sheaf to all the elements in indexed by the arrows in the covering. So you see, all of this is very natural. And so, of course, all of this allows us to define sheaves as the pre-sheaves such that every matching family indexed by any covering sieve in the topology has a unique amalgamation. So we require, in a completely analogous way as what was happening in the topological setting, the existence of the possibility of gluing things along covering families, provided that the compatibility conditions are satisfied. Okay, so then Grothendieck decided not just to consider sheaves in an isolated way, one from the other, but to consider them all together, namely to construct the category of all sheaves on a given site. And this was really a great idea, because of course the resulting category will be in general quite big, but a great advantage of considering these categories of sheaves is the categorical properties that they satisfy. We already saw this yesterday in the topological setting, that all the categories of sheaves of sets on a topological space possess the very pleasant categorical properties. They were both complete and co-complete. So they had all small limits and co-limits, which of course is very pleasant, because many problems that one encounters in mathematics are actually due to the fact that the structures with which one works often have holes. They don't allow certain operations to be made. And so you see, when you get to the topos level, basically all computations become possible because of this very rich categorical structure. And so already you see in the topological setting, it was a very very interesting metamorphosis, to use Grothendieck's word, from the classical notion of topological space to the notion of category of sheaves on a space, because you see, a topological space by itself is not something with a lot of structure. While by passing from a topological space to its associated category of sheaves, you get all this enormous categorical structure, and so you can make a lot of computations, which then you can try to reinterpret from the point of view of the topological space, which served for generating the topos. Mm? So you see, you have two levels, the level of sites, which generalize the setting of topology, and the level of toposes attached to these sites, on which invariants are naturally defined, and then it becomes very interesting to study the duality which exists between the two levels. In particular, we shall see that a key ingredient of the bridge technique is precisely the study of how invariants defined at the topos theoretic level express themselves in the context of different sites, or more generally, presentations of the toposes. Okay, so a Grothendieck topos is defined formally as any category equivalent to the category of sheaves on a site. Mm-hmm. So this is a constructive definition. Of course, as we mentioned already yesterday, there is a fundamental ambiguity in this definition, in the sense that one in principle could have different sites giving rise to equivalent topposes. But this ambiguity shouldn't be seen as a negative element, because in fact, as we shall see especially tomorrow, it formalizes precisely the phenomenon which occurs when different languages are used to describe the same structures. So it expresses a very general form of mathematical duality or equivalence. And so, in fact, it is really possible to exploit this ambiguity in a fruitful way. So all the bridge technique, in fact, will be about that. Okay, so now, before going to that, let's remark that, in fact, the notion of topos is quite powerful, because it generalizes in a very natural way fundamental notions with which we are extremely familiar, such as categories, topological spaces, or groups. In fact, we have already seen that for any small category, we have a topos attached to that, which is just the topos of three sheaves on this category, which we can regard, of course, as sheaves with respect to the trivial topology. In fact, this topos could be seen really as an extension of our category. In fact, it is the free colimit completion of the category. And to a certain extent, these toposes actually generalize categories, in the sense that you cannot quite recover the category from the associated topos, but almost, in the sense that you can recover the Cauchy completion of the category from the topos, as the full subcategory on its irreducible objects. So the Cauchy completion is actually a quite innocent operation, because it corresponds precisely to splitting all idempotents in the category. So for instance, if you have a category with finite limits, it will be automatically Cauchy complete. And so you see that just up to Cauchy completions, really we can identify categories with the corresponding toposes. Then, of course, we have already remarked that to any topological space we can attach a topos, which is just the usual category of sheaves of sets on it. This, as we said yesterday, doesn't strictly generalize topological spaces, because in general one cannot recover a topological space from the corresponding topos unless the space is sufficiently separated. Okay, so yesterday we considered that these categories of sheaves of sets on a topological space, and I already remarked that you cannot in general recover a space from the associated category of sheaves unless the space was sufficiently separated. The formal definition is sober. So a space is sober if every irreducible closed set is the closure of a unique point. So in fact, most of the topological spaces which naturally arise in mathematics are already sober, such as compact Hausdorff spaces or any underlying space of a scheme is sober. So if you want in, if you work in algebraic geometry, you don't have to worry about this. This is due to the fact that, in fact, what is not possible to recover is not the open sets of the space. We saw yesterday that the open sets could be recovered as the subterminal objects in the topos. But what you cannot in general recover is the points of the space, because yesterday we showed that any point of the space gave rise to an adjunction, so to a point of the an adjunction with the property that the left adjoint preserves the finite limits, and so we shall see later that this gives a notion of point of the corresponding topos, but actually there could be other points. There could be other points in the topos which do not come from the points of the space. And also, I mean, if the space is not sufficiently separated, in fact, there could be not enough open sets to separate distinct points. So this is why in fact, toposes are not strictly generalizations of topological spaces, but they are just a generalization of sober topological spaces. Or, if you want to think in terms of a pointless topology, they are a generalization of frames. Because, of course, when you consider a frame, F, then you put the canonical topology on this frame, basically you can recover the frame from that still by taking the subterminal objects, as in the topological setting. And so in this way you get really an identification between a frame and the corresponding topos. In fact, the frames, when you decide to regard them from a topological viewpoint, are also called locales. And so what one says is that toposes of this form, which are called localic toposes, actually generalize locales. So talking about a locale or the associated localic topos is exactly the same. Okay, now toposes actually generalize discrete groups, but more generally, in fact, you can build a topos out of any topological group by considering the continuous actions of the group on the discrete sets. So actually you can see that this is a Grothendieck topos by exhibiting a site for that, which is actually an atomic site, because so the category of continuous actions of the topological group on discrete sets is denoted by this. When you take the full subcategory of that on the non-empty transitive actions, you actually get a site of definition for that, because you can show that this topos is equivalent to the category of sheaves on this subcategory with respect to the atomic topology which we introduced earlier. Of course, in general, the the equivalence which identifies two topological groups when they have equivalent associated topos is non-trivial. It becomes trivial in the discrete case, but not in general. I mean, for topological groups, this relation is called Morita equivalence, and it is by no means trivial. In fact, we shall see some interesting examples of that tomorrow in the lecture. Okay, so now let's resume the basic properties of these categories of sheaves. Well, exactly as in the topological setting, we have that the inclusion of sheaves into pre-sheaves admits a left adjoint, which is called the associated sheaf functor. So it is a functor which actually provides for any pre-sheaf its best approximation to a sheaf. And this functor preserves finite limits. Concerning the categorical structure present on these categories, we have all small limits, just because the sheaf condition can be expressed in terms of limits, and the limits commute with limits. So actually limits can be computed just in the category of pre-sheaves, and one can immediately see that the limit of a diagram of sheaves will be again a sheaf. In particular, the terminal sheaf, the terminal object of the category of sheaves, is simply the functor which sends any object of the category to the singleton. Okay, what about colimits? As in the topological setting, colimits are first computed in the category of pre-sheaves, and then you apply the associated sheaf functor to the result, and this will give colimits in the category of sheaves, just because, when you start with a sheaf, and you sheafify it, you still get the same functor. So what you have is that here you have the inclusion, then the associated sheaf functor, and you have that the identity functor that is isomorphic to that composition. And so, since the associated sheaf functor preserves all colimits because it has a right adjoint, we know that colimits are computed in this way. Another nice property that these categories of sheaves have is the existence of exponentials for any pair of objects. In fact, exponentials are calculated as in the category of pre-sheaves. And in fact, if you want to understand how to calculate, how to construct an exponential in a category of pre-sheaves, you just have to use the universal property of exponentials together with the Yoneda lemma. Okay, another important aspect of these categories of sheaves is the existence of a subobject classifier. So what is a subobject classifier? Well, by definition, it is an object which is usually denoted by omega, which classifies the subobjects in the category. So the property is this. So the object omega is characterized by the property that the arrows from a given object A, arbitrary, to omega are in natural bijective correspondence with the subobjects of A in the category. So this is called the subobject classifier. So in fact the subobject classifier can be concretely constructed in any category of sheaves by taking the J-closed sheaves on the category. Okay, then another crucial property of these categories of sheets is the fact that actually they have generators. What I've written there, separating sets of objects. So what is a separating set of objects? It is a collection of objects. So you have E, and you say that C, which is a subclass of the collection of objects of A, is separating if for any object A of E, the collection of arrows from objects of C to A is epimorphic. So it means that if I wanted to understand when two arrows between objects in the topos are equal, it suffices to consider their composition with arbitrary arrows from objects in C, in the separating set, to A. Now, can we find a canonical choice of a separating set of objects for a Grothendieck topos? Well, there is certainly a natural choice you can make if your topos is presented as the category of sheaves on a certain site. Then, of course, you have a canonical functor which goes from the category to the topos. So first, you have the Yonida embedding which goes from C to the pre-sheaf topos. And then you have the associated sheaf functor. So if you consider this composite functor, this is actually called the canonical functor sending the category to the topos. And actually, by the Yonida lemma, you can immediately see that the objects coming from the category under this canonical functor form a separating set for the topos. About sites or separating sets of objects is quite similar because in fact conversely if you have a separating set of objects for a topos you can equip this with a certain Grothendieck topology which will be induced by the canonical topology on the topos and you will get a site of a presentation for your topos. In fact, in this way you don't get all sites, you get just a wide class of sites which are called the subcanonical sites, but still, I mean, this shows that there is a very strict relationship between sites and separating sets. In fact, one intuition that I can give you for understanding this is think about a topological space and a notion of base for this space. In fact, you see, you can have in general many different bases for a given space, but each of these bases is generating the space. And in fact, when you go at the topos theoretic level, you see that the category of sheaves on a space is equivalent to the category of sheaves on any of its bases with respect to the induced topology. So all of this is just a categorification of that. Already, this shows that you can have completely different sites of definition for the same topos. So think already about topological spaces, you see that there can be in general bases, different bases for the space, which are not equivalent, that you cannot even relate directly to each other, but which present the same space and which therefore will give rise to the same category of sheets. But we shall come back to that when we illustrate the topospheretic approach to stone type dualities. Okay, so now let's go on by introducing the fundamental notion of morphism between toposes. This is the geometrically motivated notion because, of course, we would like every continuous map between topological spaces to induce a morphism between the associated toposes of sheets on these spaces. And so by thinking about what we get at the level of toposes, starting from a continuous map of topological spaces, we arrive at this notion of geometric morphism between toposes. So a geometric morphism is just a pair of adjoint functors. So the left adjoint is called the inverse image, the right adjoint is called the direct image, satisfying the property that the inverse image preserves finite limits. Then, of course, you can consider, given two toposes and geometric morphisms between them, a notion of geometric transformation between them, which is just taken to be a natural transformation between the inverse image functors of the two morphisms. Then we can define, thanks to this notion of morphism of toposes, the notion of point of a topos as a geometric morphism from the topos of sets to the given topos. In fact, this is a good definition because, in fact, any continuous map between topological spaces actually give rise to a geometric morphism. Well, the direct image functor is defined well in the obvious way. You see, this is the formula. So you just consider the action on the open sets by the continuous map, and then you decide that the value of the direct image of a sheaf on a given open set V is the value of the sheaf at the inverse image open set. Then there are various ways you can use to describe the inverse image of this morphism, but one appealing way is to use the correspondence between sheaves on a space and the etal bundles on this local homeomorphisms to this space. So in these terms, the inverse image functors can be described as the pullback operation of etal bundles along the given continuous map. Okay, so we see that in fact any continuous map gives rise to an adjunction, and in fact you can show that the inverse image functor preserves finite limits, so we indeed get a geometric morphism. And in fact, if your spaces are sober, every geometric morphism between the associated sheaf toposes comes from a unique continuous map between the spaces. So you see that really it is the good notion. Then we have that every Grothendieck topos, just by the fact that it is defined as a topos of sheaves on sets, admits a structure morphism to the topos of sets, whose direct image is the so-called global sections functor, which takes the arrows from the terminal object of the topos to an arbitrary object, and the left adjoint to that is the functor which sends every set to the coproduct of the terminal object indexed over the elements of this set. Then, of course, we have another fundamental example of geometric morphism, which is the pair of adjoint functors given by the inclusion of sheaves into pre-sheaves and the associated sheaf functor, which goes in the other direction. This is a geometric morphism because, in fact, one can show that the associated sheaf functor always preserves finite limits. Now, there is a very important result relating geometric morphisms with a particularly important class of functors, because one in practice is interested in understanding geometric morphisms to a given topos of sheaves. So one wants to understand in a possibly more concrete way the morphisms going from a given topos to a topos of sheaves on site. And well, you see here we have a canonical morphism. It is a geometric morphism from this topos to this, so we can try to understand first the geometric morphisms to a pre-sheaf topos, and then building on that we will try to characterize those which factor through such a canonical inclusion, and so we will also get a description of those starting from the description in the pre-sheaf case. Okay, so to understand these geometric morphisms, so we have to recall that whenever you have a functor A from a small category C to a locally small co-complete category E, this functor induces a sort of Ohm tensor adjunction between the category E and the pre-sheaf topos on C in the following way. So we have a generalized Ohm functor given by this functor which I have called RA, and this functor admits a left adjoint which can be seen as a generalized tensor product. In fact, it is defined as the unique co-limit preserving functor which makes this diagram commute up to isomorphism. So you can see this, and actually the idea to understand geometric morphisms to a pre-sheaf topos is to observe the following. That so if you have a geometric morphism like this, you will have the inverse image which goes in this direction. And the inverse image will have to preserve arbitrary collimits because it has a right adjoint, namely the direct image. And since this is the free collimit completion of C, actually the behavior of this functor is uniquely determined by its composite with the Ionida embedding. So this is the idea between the behind the representation of geometric morphisms in terms of suitable functors from the category to E. So this functor will be given simply by the composite of the inverse image with the Ionida embedding. Then the point is how to characterize these functors. Because you see, this this functor is not just characterized by the fact that it has a right adjoint. It, moreover, preserves finite limits. And so you see, if you start from an arbitrary functor, then you will get, yes, an adjunction, but this adjunction will give a geometric morphism only if this left adjoint preserves finite limits. And so this leads us to introduce the notion of flat functor. So we say that a functor is flat if this left adjoint preserves finite limits. Okay, as you can expect, we have an equivalence between, on the one hand, the category of geometric morphisms to the pre-sheaf topos, and on the other hand, the category of these functors. So this is, of course, quite useful because it makes the description of geometric morphisms quite concrete. After all, I mean, you can understand them just by seeing how they act on the representables. Now we look at what happens in the sheaf case. Well, in the sheaf case, you will just have to understand which conditions you have to put on the functor for the corresponding geometric morphism to factor through this. And you understand that the condition you have to put is this J continuity condition, which means the following. A functor is said to be J continuous if it sends covering sieves to epimorphic families. And so in this way, you get an equivalence. This is a very fundamental result which has a lot of applications, in particular in connection with the classifying topologies, of which we shall talk extensively tomorrow. This is what I wanted to say, but I would conclude today's lecture by mentioning a concrete characterization of flatness that it is possible to have. So, in fact, flat functors can be equivalently characterized as functors that are filtering in the sense of this definition. Well, of course, if the category in which they are defined has finite limits, then a functor is flat if and only if it is finite limit preserving. So this definition of filtering becomes interesting in the non-Cartesian case. So suppose, for instance, that the target topos is the topos of sets, then a functor is filtering if and only if its category of elements is filtered as a category. In fact, the general notion of filtering functor to an arbitrary topos is just a reinterpretation of the filtering condition in the internal stack semantics of the topos. So it is just a reformulation of this condition using the language of generalized elements in the topos. So, I mean, if you understand what it means in the set theoretic case, you can make a perfect sense of this more general definition. Okay, so finally, I would like to mention that there are two standard ways to induce geometric morphisms between topos, one covariant, another one contravariant. The idea is to consider functors between sites with suitable properties so that they can induce geometric morphisms between the associated categories of sheaves. So one considers in particular two classes of functors, the morphisms of sites and the comorphisms of sites. So the morphisms of sites will induce geometric morphisms in the opposite direction, while comorphisms of sides will induce geometric morphisms in a covariant way. So what is a morphism of sides? The natural way to define it is as a functor such that it's composite with the canonical functor for the codomain topos is flat and J continuous. Then, of course, one might want a more concrete characterization of this, which one can achieve in full generality, but in full generality it is a bit burdensome to give. If you want to get this definition, you can take, for instance, my paper on denseness conditions. For the moment, we can limit ourselves to saying that in the Cartesian case, so if our categories C and D have finite limits, then a morphism of sides, F is a morphism of sides if and only if it preserves the finite limits and it is cover preserving. So just add this condition. So we need also it to send J covering sieves to K covering sieves. So we perfectly understand what happens in the Cartesian case. In the general case, it is a bit more subtle just because of the filtering property for general functors, but still we have a concrete characterization of them. Then we have the notion of comorphism of sites, which is a sort of dual notion. It is a functor which satisfies the cover reflecting property, which means that if I take a covering sieve in the codomain category on an object which comes from the functor, then there should be a covering sieve in the base category whose image under the functor is contained into that sieve. Mm? And so the basic theorem is this one. So you see, an immediate application of this is to see how the how a continuous map between topological spaces induces the geometric morphism between the corresponding toposes, because you go through the sites of open sets and you realize that, of course, these have finite limits. And so if you consider the canonical topology, you realize that this is a morphism of sets. So when you go at the topos theoretic level, you get a geometric morphism going in the other direction, which is actually the geometric morphism induced by F. Okay, so I stop for today. So tomorrow we shall start by reviewing the view of toposes as mathematical universes, then we shall present classifying toposes, and finally we shall talk about toposes as unifying ranges. Thank you.